Good morning.
I think that it's probably time now that we get started. Everybody sort of wandered in after a late night last night. We have a program today that is designed to put some tools in your hand that you can use when you're working on the issues that we've come together to explore here. Our first speaker today is Richard Earle. He will explore the realms suggested in his book titled, The Art of Cause Marketing. Promoting a cause requires some special skills and cautions, often not considered when preparing conventional campaigns for products and services. Richard will explain these principles and show some examples of successful implementation in a number of national cause marketing campaigns. The presentation will include possible future applications for you. So without any further ado, I'd like to introduce to you Richard Earle.
Well, good morning.
Good morning.
I have to say at the outset that I'm listed in the program as the president of Green Branch Enterprises. That was my little company. It doesn't exist anymore. And as you can see on the first slide, I am now affiliated with a group in Leesburg, Virginia, called the Regis Group, and we are some senior consultants. And we're scattered all over the country, but we get together in Leesburg. And a gentleman asked John Fleischacker yesterday in the question period, are you a dog person? I thought I would start with that credential. Here's our website, and it's a standard website, but I want you to know that Mark Chenoy, who's the chairman of the Regis Group, has a black lab named Clyde, and he wouldn't hear of it when I redid his website if he did not include Clyde as a senior member of our staff. So there he is, and if you go to the website, you'll see this. I'd like to read the text there. Clyde, who prefers to be addressed by his first name, functions as the Regis Group's chief morale officer. In addition to contributing to the cardio fitness of Regis Group officers, employees, and associates, Clyde plays a significant role in most of our group meetings. From a key vantage point under the conference table, Clyde has a unique technique of signaling when the discussion has gone on too long or is becoming unproductive. I will try to be as delicate as I can, but his signal is, it creates a lot of wrinkling of noses around the table. And Mark has to get up and walk in, so that's fine. Just to take it a little further, usually the president's page in a website like this has the president in a wonderful three-piece suit. Mark wouldn't have it unless we use the picture of him and Clyde. So, personally, this is my wife and daughter and our wonderful lab, Duchess. Sadly, left us about 4 years ago. But her official name, AKC name, was Earle's Duchess of Duane. We lived on Duane Street. And my daughter, who's in the picture with Duchess and was very fond of, produced a grandchild about 8 years ago. And so for her eighth birthday, she got Sherlock. And Sherlock is a true rescue dog of who knows what lineage, but she loves her. And so enough of the credentials. So let's get into the hardcore techniques of cause marketing. Now, I was in advertising, in conventional advertising, for about 35 years. I worked on Procter & Gamble, I worked on Johnson & Johnson, I worked on Revlon. And I thought I had retired. And a friend got me involved with the Mass Department of Public Health. And they were about to launch a large anti-smoking campaign, which was funded by a voter initiative. It was funded by a tax on cigarettes, so it was a clear deal. And I helped them find an agency and then stayed on as their advertising consultant. And over 7 years of working on that campaign, I realized that a lot of the things that we did in conventional advertising, many of them apply when you do cause marketing or social marketing. But there are some things that don't apply to product advertising. And so I want to talk about those for a moment. Here's a little bit of advertising 101. I do teach a course at the Harvard School of Public Health called Managing a Social Marketing Campaign. So this is a little bit of our syllabus of that course, just to kind of set up the principles. First of all, everything grows out of research, and particularly in this area, research is terribly, terribly important. There are two kinds of research, qualitative and quantitative. Quantitative is just the numbers of people who might have seen your message, but qualitative research has focus groups, and you really get into the people's head, and you see what how they react to your message. So decisions in this area are often driven by science, and that's a very important aspect of what we're doing. So the first thing that you do is you devise a marketing strategy, and as the second thing is to do a creative strategy. So your marketing objective is often a broader objective. And it frankly asks the question, why are we marketing at all? And there are some organizations that come to me and I say, you're doing fine, you don't need a big marketing strategy. But most of them do. So it's a statement of your goals. And you should limit it as much as possible. You should try to really focus it. Now, after you do a marketing strategy, you do an advertising strategy, and that is even more limited. It's the specific objectives of whatever campaign you're doing. This is my favorite quote about strategies, and it's by the creative director of a wonderful agency called Ogilvy & Mather in New York City. Vague strategies inhibit, precise strategies liberate. And you know, I was listening to John yesterday morning, and he was talking about the importance when you write a legal document of being very, very precise. The same thing applies here. And the great thing about doing a very precise strategy is that if your strategy is loose, the creative people, the team of writers and art directors that work on your campaign, they love to think about winning a big award and creating a buzz around what they do. And they go off on flights of fantasy. And what I'm saying is that if you have a very precise strategy, then they can do the flights of fantasy, but the objectives are very, very clearly laid out. I'm going to show you an example in a minute of a very creative commercial that was written to a very precise strategy. So you'll see how that works. So these are the elements in a, it's become called in the industry a creative brief. When I started in the advertising business, which was about the time of Mad Men. I can't believe it. I don't know if you watched that show. It's inaccurate in some ways, but it did take me back. But we always called it a strategy. But target is so important. It's who you want to talk to, what constituencies you most need to reach, and what do we know about them? When I started, a target was usually expressed as a demographic. It was men over 35 with a certain income, blah, blah, blah. I quote in my book a couple of wonderful quotes from some experts in the area. There's a book called Truth, Lies, and Advertising, and man named John Steele wrote it, and he said, it's usually expressed as age 35 with large household incomes. That was the way it used to be expressed. And that could include Bill Clinton, Billy Graham, Michael Jackson, Michael Jordan, Donald Trump, Bob Dole, the San Francisco police chief, and a large number of successful drug dealers. Now, that's not a very precise target. There's another very good book about writing a copy called Hey Whipple, Squeeze This. Title. He suggests pretending you're writing a letter and visualizing the person you're writing to. She's not a female, 18 to 34, household income of blah, blah, blah. She's a woman named Jill who's been thinking about getting a newer, smaller car. She's in an airport, bored, trying to get a gummy bear out of her back teeth, and reading Time magazine from back to front. Now, that's a little over the top, but you get the idea. You can visualize the person, and particularly if you're marketing a cause, you have to really get into the head of the person you're talking to. Competitive climate in product advertising. If you're advertising Tide, you want to know what Bold or Era are saying. In your case, you've got some competition out there. You've got the other groups that we've been talking about. You know what they're saying about you and about the issues. So you've got to be very well aware of them before you start. Principal idea. When I used to take on a new account, I would meet with the president of the company, and I'd sit in his office, and he would tell me 65 things about his product that made it better than the competition. And my job was to select the single one advantage that would give a compelling commercial about his product. So a TV commercial, for example, has 75 words. If you're talking about more than a single idea, you're probably going to have a confusing commercial. Sometimes in the area of cause marketing, you can have a couple, but that's the maximum. Support points is simply why should people believe us. We call it an arsenal of proof. If you have a creative team working on your project, you list a whole bunch of things, but they have to support the central idea. And here's a little note. They don't have to all be used in every communication, but if you're writing a full-page ad in the newspaper, you make use of many of them. Desired action. Now, this seems like a of course, but it's interesting. I was on a committee in Massachusetts that was selecting an agency to work on the anti-smoking thing, and a group came in with a beautiful presentation, a very elaborate PowerPoint. Everybody on the committee was blown away, and they all voted for them, and I voted against them, and they said, wait a minute, you're the advertising guy. What's that all about? And I said, they are telling, not selling. They got us very involved with the issue. We all said, oh, isn't that terrible? But they gave no action that you can take. And it's very, very important in this area that you have a specific action that you take from the communication. You can talk all you want about the terrible situation that you're dealing with, but if there's no action, if there's no 800 number or this is what you can do, then you're wasting your money. Finally, tone and style. And I think this is the area that this was always a very important element when I started in advertising. I've noticed when I'm dealing with mainstream agencies that this is often now omitted from the creative brief, and I think that's a terrible lack. I think the most mistakes that are made in social marketing are when tone and style is not clearly spelled out. Once again, the creative group says, oh, I'm going to win a Clio award, I'm going to do the funniest commercial you ever saw, but for a very serious subject. And there's a disconnect in tone and style. It's very, very important. I'll show you an example in a moment of where someone has really rooted it in this area. So I think it's the most important section. Okay, now that I've talked about the general outlines of a creative brief or strategy, I'm just going to show you a quick a commercial that we did for the Massachusetts Tobacco Control Program. And this is the actual strategy to which this was written. I'll go through it rather quickly, but you'll see how the broad ideas or the basic building blocks of the strategy are interpreted. First of all, our target was opinion leaders, and this is a very specific thing. These are people who go to meetings in their town, who go to their town council meetings, who support their legislator, who write letters. It's like all the people in this room, frankly. And that's who we were talking to with this campaign. Competitive climate. This was a campaign to eliminate the ease of purchasing of cigarettes from kids. Basically, we wanted to ban cigarette machines because these are often around the corner where they can't be monitored by the mom and pop who are running the store. And that's where the kids told us that most of them got their cigarettes. Also, the ease of purchasing. We wanted to put some strict regulations in place. And it was interesting. I went to a town meeting in our town in Gloucester, Mass, and we had just such a proposal. And a lot of these little mom and pop store owners were there, and they started to talk about the economic hardships. Oh my gosh, if we lose the cigarette machines, we're going to go out of business. And it's interesting how they started to all mouth the same words. And I realized there was a guy from the tobacco lobby in the back of the room who was coaching. Okay, key message, principal message, access is the key to prevention. If kids can't get cigarettes while they're young, they're less likely to start smoking. This is sport boys. Desired action, if we can make it harder for kids to buy cigarettes, especially from vending machines, we can keep them from becoming smokers, a very specific action. Tone and style was serious and urgent. I'm going to show you the commercial. I like this commercial a lot because it's a perfect example of how creative you can be with a very rigid strategy. We got a very well-known Hollywood director to direct this. He liked what we were doing. He cleared his schedule. And he shot the storyboard, which was very specific, and the idea of the commercial was quite simple. It was showing little kids getting cigarettes and actually playing with them, almost as though they were Lego toys, and intercut with actual emphysema patients and patients with lung disease, and the intercut of the beautiful, innocent little faces and the people with the tubes in their nose was a very strong idea. And he shot the storyboard exactly. Of course, he brought with him a Hollywood editor. And the editor, as he was cutting this footage together, said, you know, there's a wonderful soundtrack, a music track that I like. It's Sly and the Family Stone's interpretation of that sappy old Doris Day song, Que Sera Sera, but it was the Sly kind of irony in the delivery. And the footage just fell together perfectly. So we ended up with a very creative commercial created to a very rigid storyboard.
Around.
principal idea. It's sometimes not the one you start out expecting, and this is something that you have to be prepared for, and research will guide you. This is a commercial that was done by some people that I admire a lot, the Partnership for Drug-Free America. They are not the government agency, but they are an independent agency group, and they were the first to really start to attack this issue. And when they first started, they decided to stay away from the inner city because it would seem like a cliche that drugs are only a problem within the black community and so on. So they started in middle America, they started in the heartland, if you will. But they realized that at some point they had to deal with the inner city. And the presumption was, the going in presumption was that the drug dealers in Harlem and in places like that were kind of the Robin Hoods of the hood, if you will. The kids would kind of look up to them. They had all the big cars and the jewelry and the women. And it turned out, as they did a lot of research with the kids that they wanted to talk to, that many of these kids were very, very scared of the drug dealers. They didn't like them. They tried to avoid them, but they didn't want to be perceived as nerds, if you will, within their peers. So the partnership did a very interesting commercial, which I think talks directly to those kids. So I want to show that to you.
My teacher tells us to just say no. Policemen said the same thing. They don't have to walk home through here. Because the dealers are scared of police. But they're not scared of me. And they don't take no for an answer.
To Kevin Scott and all the other kids who take the long way home, we hear you. Don't give up.
That one won a lot of awards, and it deserved to. The two teams we're talking about, first of all, Target. When I was doing research for this book, I met the researcher who had done the initial research on the infamous Just Say No campaign. And she assured me that it was designed for children 10 and under. Understand that. Just Say No, that's all you had to say to those kids. Nancy Reagan, a very sincere woman, saw this commercial and said, that's going to be the national campaign against drugs, Just Say No. And so she used, the government adopted it and they ran it to a number of different audiences, particularly teenagers. And I saw one on MTV one night and said, Just Say No. It's a little bit like saying to a manic depressive, cheer up. and Nancy Reagan was reported to go into drug rehabilitation centers and talk to 35-year-old men, recovering addicts. They just say no. And that was a mistake. It was designed specifically for a very, very young age group. The second is this area of tone and style. I want to show you three commercials done by the Partnership for Drug-Free America. And although I'm not certain about this, I'm fairly certain that these were all done to the same strategy, except that somehow the tone and style statement got lost. The strategy, again, was counterintuitive. It grew out of research. It's a very good strategy. The presumption was that kids did not want to hear from their parents about drugs. They wanted to hear from their peers, the kids in their class. It turns out, in doing research, that many of these kids said, I wish my parents would talk to me. They even did some paired research. They interviewed 500 kids and said, do your parents ever talk to you about drugs? Only about 18% said they ever did. They interviewed the parents of those same kids. Do you ever talk to your kids about drugs? 80% said, of course we do. So there was a disconnect. And so this is their talk to your kids campaign. Three commercials. I think the first and the third are terrific. I think the middle one is a disaster because someone did not pay attention to tone and style. And I think in a way, you're talking to parents, this is, somebody had fun with this, and you're really insulting the parents. So Numbers 1 and 3 are great. The middle one is a disaster.
Probably getting it anyway. Just not deserve it.
Okay. This is a commercial that was done in Massachusetts that I admire a lot. Here's a caution. Keep it simple. If you're doing a campaign and you can come up with an acronym that is very, very simple. This is for stroke prevention. Okay, we're powered up. This is an interesting acronym. It was the three things that you should learn about recognizing a stroke. And it seems dead simple, particularly because the commercial is animated and it seems to be talking to kids. And by all means, this can be understood by kids. But it's talking about the three areas that you look for a symptom: face, arm, speech, and then it's time to call 911. And the acronym spells out FAST. So it's a dead simple, but I think a very actionable campaign.
Someone you love could be having a stroke. Learn these signs, act fast, give them hope.
Face.
Does he droop when you ask them to smile?
Arm.
Does one trip down on either side?
Speech.
Does it sound confused or strange? Then it's time to call 911.
Face, arms, speech, time, act fast.
With every second, brain cells die. Call 911 at any sign of stroke.
Act fast.
Give a loved one hope.
That's simple, but very, very memorable. Okay, remember, telling, not selling. Ask for the order. Pick a memorable tagline or an 800 number. There was a memorable tagline. Speak with one voice. If you have a PR department, make sure that they're familiar with your strategy so that every time you put out a release, it really reinforces your single idea. So, I promised to show you some of the commercials that will make you very mad. And you're probably all familiar with these, but I downloaded them from their website. And I want to comment a little bit on them because that's what's out there and you better be aware of it. They like to shock people, and I think that right away is a terrible idea for anyone trying to do cause marketing because, yes, they get the buzz, they get people talking about it, but what does it say about the sponsoring organization? And we'll talk a little bit about branding in a minute. But first of all, here's their approach to spaying and neutering. And it's interesting that it very well parallels that terrible anti-drug spot.
Honey, we need to talk.
About sex.
Yeah, we think you should be having it, sweetie.
A lot of it.
Get up there and nail everything you can.
If it's got a pulse, you should be wrapped around it.
What if I get pregnant?
So what? You should pop out all the kids you want.
Absolutely.
Yeah, we can leave them in the shelter, dump them in the street,
it's
whatever.
It's really not important.
I'm really glad we had this little talk.
My little girl's gonna get some.
Now, this one will make you really mad. Many of the people in this room, this one I just cannot believe that they did.
Yeah, oh yeah, we've seen that one.
That's a great point, Cindy, and that's why it's important for us to continue to dock the tails, crop the ears, and create that clean look that's so important. I'm sorry, sir. I think you have the wrong meeting.
Oh, is this the American Kennel Club?
Yes, but, you know, we're dismissing...
You believe in the sanctity of pure bloodlines, right?
Yes.
And breeding to achieve a master race?
Well, master pedigree. They're...
Race, pedigree, I mean, that's just all semantics. You want to fit right in here.
You're my kind of people.
minutes later.
Equating with racism. Actually, the first commercial, despite its tone, it's kind of insulting, probably gets the message across. This one insults everybody. I just cannot believe that they think this is an effective thing. It is so confrontational, and it's such an inane premise that I can't think but that this is backfiring big time for them. I want to show you one more done by Fred. Yes? Big pardon?
Are they allowed to use the AKC logo like that? Is that
It's something to consider. I have no idea. Your attorneys might be able to do something about that. A lot of these organizations rush into production. These are quite well produced, by the way. The casting is good, the acting is good, the camera work. The commercial I'm about to show you is from Friends of Animals. And this one was never got on the air. And it ran up against the network clearance people. I don't know whether it's because the woman was perceived to be nude under the fur or because there's so much blood at the end. I think it could have been fixed, but they went ahead and spent a lot of money to produce this commercial. It never aired, but it's an interesting approach that they take. Director on Volkswagen at the time, And the end line of all the Volkswagen advertising of that era was, there are in the road of life, there are passengers and drivers, and then they were just super drivers wanted. As Ron put it in, when he presented this campaign, do you want to join the passengers club? No, you want to be the driver. So, very, very subtle stuff. Yes?
Is it accurate to say that branding is similar to identity politics?
Identity what?
Politics?
Yes, we call, when we do a branding assignment for a client, we do something called an identity package. And yes, it's very, very similar. And it's very important these days. When I was actively working for an agency, there was a group called Trout and Reese, and they like to quote Fats Waller, find out what they like and how they like it and let them have it just that way. But branding has moved on. The first group to really brand their products with a lot of money and a lot of research are the tobacco merchants. I mean, the Marlboro Cowboy, that is ultimate branding, independence and so on. Joe Camel became a kind of a cool, hip symbol for them. Virginia Slims, you've come a long way, baby, feeding into the women's movement. Very successful branding of those really terrible products. So you've got to really understand your target. You have a creative use of imagery, and the tone and style and personality and attitude are very important. Here's a book I hope you know about. Malcolm Gladwell wrote a fascinating book. When you meet someone for the first time, walk into a house you're thinking of buying, or read the first few sentences of a book, your mind takes about 2 seconds to jump to a series of conclusions. I think those instant conclusions that we reach are really powerful and really important. Your branding, your identity package, if you will, has to, within the first couple of seconds, say a lot about who you are and what you are. Here's a very successful piece of branding. You all know what that is. What company is that?
I didn't know.
There's another one. Target.
I didn't know. I'm not a consumer.
I'm going to show you three real classic branding commercials. The Got Milk campaign was a very interesting one. The California Dairy Association realized that milk use was declining. I mean, the bottle or the carton of milk in the refrigerator was a staple. It was almost, it was a place for it always. And that was no longer there. And the idea was to reduce it to its essence, the idea of just gut milk. It's essential. And once they established that brand, they were allowed to have great flights of fancy. This first commercial is a very weird one, but it's a funny spot. And it's a guy stuffing his mouth with a peanut butter sandwich, and he's out of milk, and he can't speak. The second one for Target, and this is an old one. This is probably 6 years ago. They were starting this. But it's a discount store. It's a place to get a good price, but it's cool. And everything about the imagery, the use of the old music, the retro music, if you will, helped them a lot. And the final one is a Volkswagen. It's the Drivers Wanted campaign. So let's look at those three.
Vienna would dancing be one of my all-time favorites. And now let's make that random call with today's $10,000 question. It's a tough one. Who shot Alexander Hamilton in that famous duel? All right, let's go to the phones and see who's out there.
This, as was the case with this, they ended up turning it around on them when you establish a identity like this, aren't you running that risk of, you know, your opponents turning it around on you?
So who turned around?
PETA turned it around on them with the Got Beer ads that they did for a while.
I think I feel if you imitate someone, you remind people of the original branding. I think the gut milk thing was so well ingrained that that just helped them. I don't think that hurt them a bit.
They don't have to break
the household names.
There are some things money can't buy, or everything else, there's MasterCard. Again, very plain language. Where the world checks in every day. I don't think this is penetrated too well. I don't think any of you could answer what that is, but it's...
What is it?
This one you can fill in the blank, I think. Just do it. They ran an entire, they were so confident in this brand line, they ran a whole commercial that just said just. And people all over America were filling in the last two words.
Not me.
You know this one?
Virginia.
That's Milton Glaser. He is the king of branding. In my view, I've worked with him a couple of times. He's a brilliant, brilliant guy.
Who is this?
Milton Glaser.
Oh. Yes.
You may remember the original Bob Dylan album covers during the late '60s, early '70s. He's a brilliant designer, but he designed the I Love New York, and he does mainly branding these days. Okay, in social marketing, icons are very important. Frying Indian, don't litter, douse your campfire, and buckle up. Also in the commercial field. So, consistency, very, very important. You've got to have a style book, and you've got to have the resources to get it out there. PR has to be consistent with it, and we'll talk about PR in a minute. Standard strategy, but very important for branding. When you do a branding strategy, you do the left brain, you do the elevator speech about who you are, and then we play a little exercise.
What's an elevator speech?
If you're riding down from the 23rd floor and the guy next to you says, what do you do? What do you work for? By the time you get to the bottom, you better, if you are a proper representative of your group, you've got to be able to tell exactly what your group does. I work for NAIA. What do they do? By the time you get to the bottom, hopefully you have that speech done. So those are some games we play. Favorite color, cliche that describes us. And it's amazing how within a group, you'll start to extract what we call the brand essence. So, conclusions.
A bold and effective tool for your organization. You've got to know what you're doing.
And as a little plug for the book, I have two of them up here if anybody wants to buy. I sold three at my table. And finally, an ego trip. I do always end these presentations with a commercial that I wrote 35 years ago, but it still has some resonance.
Oh, this was a great one. I remember this.
The first American people loved the land. They held it in simple reverence. And in some Americans today, that spirit is reborn. coast botanic garden in California. Once this was the dumping ground for trash and litter. Community volunteers cleaned, planted, and reclaimed it. And there the land is good again. But all around us are reminders of how far we still have to go. So everyone must get involved. Now, to contact the Keep America Beautiful team nearest you, write Keep America Beautiful, 99 Park Avenue, New York, New York. People start pollution. People can stop it.
Tell me that wasn't 35 years ago. I'm sorry this took so long, but I don't really have time for any questions. Okay. Yes.
Well, you've been at our conference here, and you see that NAIA is a great organization, and we're a very complex organization. So getting started marketing us is a big problem. How about a few thoughts?
Well, that's a very structured process, and my suggestion would be that we should start with branding, and you saw some of the principles of branding, and when, frankly, we, as a consultant group, we do that for a number of organizations. We spend all day going through a very structured session that starts to get the emotional essence of who you are and tries to simplify it. And so then at some point you may decide that you have an issue that you want to do some specific advertising to. Once again, it's a matter of tearing down your intentions and finding that single idea, finding a tone and style that's consistent with your brand. And it's a very structured process, but it's doable. You are a complex organization, there's no question about it, but it's very doable. Yes?
Does your process include focus groups?
I'm sorry?
Does your process include focus groups?
Focus groups are very, very helpful, yes. I think it's very appropriate to use them. I always learn from a focus group. I mean, I must have been in a thousand of them, and I'm always surprised. People don't lie. They really don't.
Could you explain the focus group concept and how it works?
Yes. You recruiting is very, very important. You must know exactly who you are targeting. Remember the very specific instructions that I... And you have to have a facility. Usually there's a facility with what we call a one-way mirror. And you as the client are sitting behind it. And it's interesting that we didn't used to tell the participants. And the famous story that as the room emptied out, there was this big mirror at the end of the room, and the woman came up and adjusted her bra. And of course, all the guys in the agency hooted, and she sued them, and it was a terrible. So from that moment on, all focus group interviewers will then say, "Now there are some people behind the one-way mirror. They're observing this, and I'm going to record this. It's just from my notes. You'll never be on TV or anything like that." It's amazing how people forget all about that. They start to interact, and a good facilitator will say, that person in the corner is leading the group, and everybody's saying, "Oh, they're smarter than I am." Shuts that person down so that you get a true interaction. But you always learn in the focus group. I absolutely live by it. Yes.
This is a vague question. I'm sure. Can you give us some basic prices, like not necessarily for you, but like if an organization wanted to, I don't know, come up with a logo or come up. I mean, are we talking like $20,000? Can you do anything at all for $500?
I went through it recently for the Regis Group. When I joined the Regis Group, we didn't really have a brand, and so we created the logo that you see there. We hired a couple of young designers. They also completely redid our website. So the total bill for that was about $20,000. It was the identity package and the website. So I don't know if that helps or not. They were, frankly, giving us a little bit of a break. If we'd been IBM, they would have. We're currently answering an RFP for an organization in the Midwest that I'm told spent like $250,000 on their logo and branding materials, which they don't like very much. So it's a little bit like saying, how much is a car? I mean, you can buy one for $11,000 or you can spend a couple hundred. So, yes. Anyone else? Okay, thank you very much.